Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and the page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. Now, before we proceed to the news article discussion, as you all are aware, from 1st of May, we have been discussing past year preliminary questions. That is, we are discussing some questions from prelims 2020 question paper. So, as part of today's discussion related to that, let us take few questions. Now see this question, with reference to history of India, consider the following pairs. They have given famous places and they are asking us to see which pairs are correctly matched. So this is a pair based question. On one side we have famous historical places and on the other side we have the state in which they are currently situated. So first let us see about Bilsa. See, this is one of the towns that emerged around temples. Earlier there was a place called as Besnagar. It was an ancient city that was located on the western side of river Betwa. However, if you take Bilsa, it was a new town that is built after the destruction of Besnagar. And this new town was known as Bailaswamin or Billaswamin. It was built up on the eastern bank of river Betwa. This name of the place was later corrupted to Bilsa or Belsa. Currently, it is known as district Vidisha. This district is located in Madhya Pradesh. From the historical aspect, Vidisha is exceptionally rich in ancient monuments and historic places. Most importantly, near the city, there are numerous remains of Buddhist stupas or Buddhist monuments of Central India. These are commonly called as Bilsa topes. So the given first pair is correctly matched. Next is Dwara Samudra. See, it is also known as Dwara Samudra. It was the ancient capital of Hoysala dynasty or Hoysala Empire in the 12th century. Hoysala dynasty ruled over much of South India for a period of around 200 years. And during this time, they have built spectacular temples, which includes both Hindu temples and also Jain temples. Presently, this is known as Halibidu and it is situated in Hasan district of Karnataka. Also, it is a ruined city, having a glorious past and is also popular for its Hoysala architecture. Most notable ones we can say the ornate Hoysaleshwara temple and Kedareshwara temple. Now coming to the question, see it is an incorrect pair because it is situated in Karnataka and not in Maharashtra. Now next is Girinagar. See it is also known as Girinagar or Revatak Parvata. It is a group of mountains in the Junagadh district of Gujarat. See the Girnar mountain and its range is considered as older than Himalayas and therefore they are also considered sacred. So it is an important pilgrimage site for both Hindus and those who follow Jainism. So here it is correctly matched. So this is a correct pair. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 and 3 only. Now, coming to Staneshwara, just know that it is now known as Staneshwar. It is adjacent to Kurukshetra and it is situated in Haryana. Staneshwar is special because it is an archaeologically important site for us. So, here the correct answer is option A. Now, see this question with reference to jet streams and cyclones. Three statements are given. They are asking which of the statements given above are correct. Jet streams occur in the northern hemisphere only. Only some cyclones develop an eye. The temperature inside the eye of a cyclone is nearly 10 degrees Celsius lesser than that of the surroundings. So in the question, first statement is about jet streams. See, jet streams are a narrow belt of high altitude westerly winds in the troposphere. High altitude here corresponds to a height of above 12 km or above 12,000 meters. So they are relatively narrow bands of strong winds in the upper levels of the atmosphere. They blow from west to east, but the flow often shifts to the north and the south. See, their speed varies from about 110 km per hour in summer to about 184 km per hour in the winter. We can identify a number of separate jet streams. Among these, the most common or the most constant are the mid-latitude jet stream or polar jet stream and the subtropical jet stream. Very importantly, note that jet streams occur in both northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere. If you take the polar jet stream, it forms at about 60 degrees latitude in both hemispheres, while the subtropical jet stream forms at about 30 degrees in both hemispheres. So based on this knowledge, if you take the first statement, it is incorrect. Now the second and third statements are about eye of the cyclones. See, as we know, tropical cyclones are violent storms that originate over oceans in tropical areas and they move over to the coastal areas. They bring large-scale destruction that is caused by violent winds. They also bring very heavy rainfall and also storm surges. And the center of such a cyclone is a calm area. And this center area, which is calm area, is called as the eye of the storm. If you take a mature tropical cyclone, it has a strong spirally circulating wind around this center. Now, the diameter of the circulating system can vary between 150 kilometers and 250 kilometers. And the diameter of the eye, it varies from 10 to 30 kilometers. If you take this region I, it is a region that is free of clouds and it has light winds or it has subsiding air. And the I is warmer than the surrounding. This fact is important. See, in warm core systems, the temperature inside the I region can be higher by as much as 10 degrees Celsius more than the surroundings. And also note that all cyclones do not develop an I or all cyclones do not become warm core systems. So keeping these facts in mind, if you approach statement 2 and 3, we can say that statement 2 is correct, but statement 3 is incorrect because the temperature inside the eye region can be higher by as much as 10 degrees Celsius than the surroundings. So the correct answer for this question is option C, 2 only. See this question, which is with reference to social cost of carbon. The question reads, which one of the following statements best describe the term social cost of carbon? It is a measure in monetary value of the long-term damage done by a ton of carbon dioxide emissions in a given year, requirement of fossil fuels for a country to provide goods and services to its citizens based on the burning of those fuels, efforts put in by a climate refugee to adapt to live in a new place, contribution of an individual person to the carbon footprint on the planet Earth. First, let us see what do we mean by social cost of carbon, then we will attempt the question. See, social cost of carbon, as per the economic survey, it is defined as a term that refers to the economic cost or the economic loss in the discounted value of economic welfare that is caused or induced by additional unit of carbon dioxide emissions. Simple terms, we can say that it measures the present value of damages incurred when an additional ton of carbon or any other greenhouse gas is released into the atmosphere. Now, this present value is expressed in monetary terms. So, it is an estimate of monetized damages that are associated with incremental increase in carbon emissions in a particular year. See, it is the central concept for the inclusion of climate change damages in the cost-benefit analysis of public policy and in public investments. So, social cost of carbon can be added as a cost item for projects which induce carbon emissions, and it also can be added as a benefit item for projects that induce a net reduction in carbon emissions. So, therefore, public projects in sectors of energy, transport and agriculture should take social cost of carbon into account as they have an impact on carbon emissions. On a whole, we can say that when social cost of carbon is included in environmental policy, it informs the optimal carbon price and the optimal level of emissions reduction or abatement. And according to researchers, the global social cost of carbon at 2010 prices for the year 2015 was $31.2 per ton carbon dioxide. And it is estimated that by the year 2030, it will rise to $51.6 per ton of carbon dioxide. For India, earlier, the social cost of carbon is estimated at 2.9 per ton by the Economic Survey 2016-17. However, according to recent studies based on some current prices, for India, it is estimated to be about $86 per ton of carbon dioxide. Just know the information. So, from this discussion, it is clear that the correct answer is option A, long-term damage done by a ton of carbon dioxide emissions in a given year. Now see this question, which is about ocean mean temperature. With reference to ocean mean temperature, which of the following statements are correct? They have given two statements. OMT is measured up to a depth of 26 degrees Celsius isotherm, which is 129 meters in the southwestern Indian Ocean during January-March. The OMT collected during January-March can be used in assessing whether the amount of rainfall in monsoon will be less or more than a certain long-term mean. So this question is about ocean mean temperature. It represents the heat available in the ocean layer to the depth of 26 degrees Celsius isotherm. See, 26 degrees Celsius isotherm in the southwestern Indian Ocean during January to March is seen at a depth of 59 meters. Generally, they say 26 degrees Celsius isotherm is seen at depth varying from 50 to 100 meters. When we say isotherm, it refers to a line that connects points having same temperature at a particular time or on an average over a given period. See, the ocean mean temperature is estimated from tropical cyclone heat potential that was computed from satellite altimeter observations. It is one of the important climatic parameters that is required for atmospheric and oceanic studies, like you can say cyclone predictions, monsoon predictions, and even ocean heat transport estimations. It is relatively a new parameter for predicting whether the total amount of rainfall that India receives during monsoon season will be less or more than the long-term mean, which is around 887.5 millimeters. So usually we use sea surface temperature for predicting this, but according to scientists, ocean mean temperature has better ability to predict this than the sea surface temperature. And it was found that sea surface temperature has only 60% success rate of predicting Indian summer monsoon. On the other hand, if you take ocean mean temperature, it has 80% success rate. So OMT is more accurate because it better represents the upper ocean thermal energy conditions. And these upper ocean thermal energy conditions are mainly responsible for the summer Indian monsoon. So therefore, scientists conclude that OMT has better summer monsoon predictability than sea surface temperature. And in addition to this, OMT also provides the required information on amount of monsoon rainfall 2 months before the southwest monsoon. That is, it will give such information that is required by beginning of April. This is because OMT is analyzed by measuring the ocean thermal energy during the period from January to March. And India's southwest monsoon sets in around June 1st each year in Kerala. And note that during January to March, the mean 26 degrees Celsius isotherm depth in southwestern Indian Ocean is 59 meters. So based on this information, we can say that statement 2 is correct, but statement 1 is incorrect. Usually we can say 26 degrees Celsius isotherm is seen at depths varying from 50 to 100 meters and not at 129 meters. And specifically we can say during January to March, the mean 26 degrees Celsius isotherm depth in southwestern Indian Ocean is 59 meters. So the correct answer for this question is option B. This news article is about India's oil imports. It mentions that India imported less from Organization of the Petroleum Exporting Countries. So in this context, let us see about OPEC, its oil export to India, and we'll also see data related to India's oil demands and imports. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. First, let us see about OPEC. See, it is a permanent intergovernmental organization of 13 oil exporting developing nations. It was created at the Baghdad Conference of 1960 by its founding members. So we can say that the institution is 60 years old. To add another fact, last year it celebrated 60th year anniversary. Now its founding members include Iran, Iraq, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia and Venezuela. Then later several countries joined. These countries include Libya, United Arab Emirates, Algeria, Nigeria, Angola, Gabon, Equatorial Guinea and Congo. Now you can note that one important country from Middle East is not a member of OPEC. This country is Qatar. See, Qatar joined OPEC in 1961, but it terminated its membership in OPEC quite recently in January 2019. So like this, many countries withdraw or terminate their membership, and the recent one to terminate is Ecuador. It withdrew in January 2020. So as a result of such leaving and joining, if you take the number of members of this organization, it is quite volatile or changing. So before the examination, it is important for us to see who are the present members. Some countries have joined OPEC again. For example, Gabon, which terminated its membership in 1995, but rejoined in 2016. Now coming to OPEC's objective, it is to coordinate and unify petroleum policies among its member countries. Now why it has to be done? This is to secure fair and stable prices for petroleum producers and also to create an efficient economic and regular supply of petroleum to the consuming nations. It also aims to provide a fair return on capital to those who are investing in this industry. Note that its headquarters is in Vienna of Austria. But we know right now the world is grappling over the pandemic that has affected everything. It also had a detrimental impact on the energy sector as well. Because of the measures taken by countries to curb the spread of the infection, oil imports were drastically reduced. Therefore, oil markets saw a downward demand, which resulted in quick filling of global oil storage. This in turn has also led to large-scale volatility in oil prices. So to tackle these issues, OPEC and its partners, they decided on a declaration of cooperation. This declaration of cooperation was an agreement to intensify collaborative efforts for restoring the market stability. Now, this resulted in the largest and longest voluntary production adjustments in the history of oil market. For the first time ever, through this declaration, in fact, member countries of OPEC even coordinated with 11 non-OPEC oil producing countries. Here, the non-OPEC countries committed to a reduction in output, or they committed to reduce total oil production together by almost 6 lakh barrels per day. Exactly, they agreed to a total production reduction of 5,50,000 barrels per day. In fact, out of this, Russian Federation alone committed to lowering its output by 3 lakh barrels per day. So now let us see certain data related to OPEC. See, first, if you take the recent available data for 2019, OPEC has around 79% of world's proven crude oil reserves. But if you see its share in world crude oil production, it is just 40%. And this, in fact, was reduced to 39% in 2019. And this is because OPEC crude oil production declined sharply in a year-on-year basis by around 1.86 million barrels per day. That amounted to 6% decline in production. On the other hand, crude oil production by non-OPEC countries, they grew by 1.3 million barrels per day. That is by 2.9%. Note that in 2019, top three crude oil producing countries were the United States, Russia and Saudi Arabia. And of this, Saudi Arabia is the OPEC country. Now, because of these factors, OPEC's share in world crude oil exports also reduced. As on 2019, world crude oil exports by OPEC amounted to 49.75%. As of 2019, world oil demand grew by 0.9% year on year, and the average demand stood at 99.67 million barrels per day. The largest increases in demand were recorded for Asia and the Pacific region, particularly by China and India, and this was followed by Africa and the Middle East. Here, note that India is the world's third largest importer of crude oil. The first two are the USA and China. Particularly, India's imports from OPEC countries were around 85% of total crude imports of India. So OPEC countries are very important if you see from crude oil import for India. However, today's news says that this scenario has changed. See, according to estimates in 2020, India's oil demand reduced by 10%. It even continued to decline in February 2021 also. Now, why there is decline? This is because of lower demand mainly for diesel, gasoline, kerosene amidst the pandemic. Now, the decline in diesel demand was because of limited demand for on-road diesel. Jet or kerosene consumption has also been negatively impacted because of lack of demand for jet fuel. Now, this was because of reduction in international flights as well as because of the substitution with liquefied petroleum gas for kerosene in the residential sector. So, this is the scenario despite improvements in economic conditions because of easing of COVID-19 restrictions in our country. But we are now facing second wave of infection, so oil demand may further reduce. But contrasting to this trend, OPEC predicts a different scenario as it predicts India's oil demand will increase by 13.5% in 2021. Now, this may be because of faith on positive policy measures that will encourage private consumption and investment. And maybe also they might have thought that COVID-19 restrictions will be further eased. Now, another OPEC official data is regarding India's crude imports by source. According to this, see, in January 2021, Iraq remained the top crude exporter to India with a share of 19%. Saudi Arabia second with 16% share, UAE third with 13% share, USA fourth with 11% share, and Nigeria fifth with 7% share. So you can see that even Nigeria is important considering our oil imports. But if you take on a whole for 2020-2021, Iraq remained India's top oil supplier This was followed by Saudi Arabia and United Arab Emirates. Earlier, Venezuela was the fourth biggest supplier to India, but this position was taken by Nigeria. And surprisingly, US emerged as the fifth biggest supplier to India. In 2019-20, US was at the seventh position. You can see how these countries become important for India's oil supplies or oil imports. Now, with respect to OPEC, the news article notes that India's oil imports from OPEC fell to the lowest in at least two decades, which is now around 72%. This is the fact given in the article. So these are some of the crucial data regarding India's oil imports and demand and the association of OPEC countries with India. And also we saw India's crude imports by source. With this information, let us move on to next article discussion. Now, this news article is about the presidential elections in Syria that is planned to be held on 26th May 2021. As expected, President Bashar al-Assad is contesting once again. The article highlights that the number of candidates contesting in this election is limited to three. Here the role of the Constitutional Court of Syria is crucial. See here, the Constitutional Court is appointed by the president himself. This court, it approves the applicants who are eligible to contest the presidential elections. In this way, the Constitutional Court has approved only 3 out of 51 applicants to contest in the presidential elections. This measure carried out by the Constitutional Court has been heavily criticized, saying that it has curtailed the right to contest by the Syrians. Additionally, Syria has invited lawmakers from allied countries like Russia, China, Iran and few other countries as observers in this election. However, the Western members of United Nations Security Council, which is led by the United States, they have rejected the outcome of this election even by now itself. So in relation to this, let us discuss a few points related to Syria's geography and polity. See, Syria is located on the east coast of Mediterranean Sea in the southwestern Asia. It is bounded by Turkey in the north. To the southeast and in the east, we can see Iraq. And in the south, we can see Jordan. And to the southwest of Syria, we can see countries like Lebanon and Israel. See, it has a relatively short coastline along the Mediterranean Sea between Turkey and Lebanon. Coming to the most important water source, it is the Euphrates River. And it is the only navigable river in Syria. This river, it originates in Turkey, then flows southeastwards across the eastern part of Syria. Now, one of the important places in the region is Golan Heights. See, this region was captured by Israel from Syria in the 1967 war. Later on, it was annexed by Israel in the year 1981. However, this move carried out by Israel is not recognized internationally. Note that in the year 2019, United States has become the first country to recognize Israeli sovereignty over this Golan Heights. Now let's come to the polity in Syria. See, Syrian Republic is an independent sovereign state. It is based on the principle of rule of the people. It is a state with a republican form of government. Also, the political system of the state is based on the principle of political pluralism and democracy. Now, let's relate the constitutional provisions of Syria with this news article. Syrian constitution mentions that candidacy applications for the presidential election will not be accepted unless the applicant has the support of at least 35 members of parliament. And no member of parliament can support more than one candidate. And note that the term of office of president in Syria is 7 years. He or she is elected on the basis of universal, equal and direct suffrage by secret ballot. But it is alleged that the provisions given in the constitution are being diluted by the role played by the constitutional courts in the approval process. So though the constitutional provisions emphasis on rule of law, democracy and regular elections, Syria is finding it difficult to realize peace and stability, more so because of the geographical location it is in and also because of the foreign interventions and related vested interest and few other factors, which could be both domestic and international. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article states that Justice Prafulla Chandra has been appointed as the acting chairperson of NHRC. That is the National Human Rights Commission. See, Justice Prafulla is a former Supreme Court judge. He was also a member of this commission. Now he has been appointed as the acting chairperson of this NHRC. In this context, let us see about NHRC, the Protection of Human Rights Act 1993, and mainly we will see the amendments that are made to this act in the year 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, NHRC was established for the protection and promotion of human rights. It was set up by an act of parliament called as the Protection of Human Rights Act of 1993. So it is a statutory body. See, it is an embodiment of India's concern for the promotion and protection of human rights. The commission inquires a complaint of violation of human rights, or it inquires a complaint of negligence in the prevention of such violation by a public servant. It also studies treaties and international instruments on human rights and make recommendations for their effective implementation to the government. Also, the commission is responsible for spreading human rights awareness among the masses and also encourages the efforts of all stakeholders in the field of human rights literacy, not only at the national level but also at the global level too. So NHRC is a unique institution, and the world looks at NHRC of India as a role model in promoting and monitoring effective implementation of promotion and protection of human rights. The Indian National Human Rights Commission also plays an active role in coordinating with other national human rights institutions of the world so as to enhance awareness from the perspective of human rights. It also has hosted delegations from UN bodies and other national human rights institutions, also from members of civil society, lawyers, political and social activists from many countries. So this is some basic about National Human Rights Commission. Now let's come to the Protection of Human Rights Amendment Act of 2019. If you take the principal act, that is the Protection of Human Rights Act 1993, it was enacted to provide for constitution of NHRC, State Human Rights Commission, and the human rights courts for the protection of human rights. NHRC proposed certain amendments to the act in 2019 so as to address the concerns raised at certain global platforms. In addition to this, certain state governments have also proposed for amendments to the principal act, as they reported that they have been facing difficulties in finding suitable candidates to the post of chairperson of the respective state commissions because of the existing eligibility criteria in the principal act of 1993. Now, in view of above issues, Protection of Human Rights Act 1993 was amended in 2019. It was reported that the proposed amendments will enable both the commission and the state commissions to be more compliant with the Paris principles in terms of autonomy, independence, pluralism, and also wide-ranging functions so as to effectively protect and promote human rights. If you take Paris principles, see, these are a set of principles defined for promotion and protection of human rights. It was given during the first international workshop on national institutions for promotion and protection of human rights, which was held in Paris in October 1991. Now let us see some of the important amendments made to this act. See, one thing is that a person who has been a judge of the Supreme Court is also now made eligible to be appointed as chairperson of the commission, in addition to the person who has been the Chief Justice of India. Earlier, a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court can be only appointed as the chairperson. But now, even a person who has been a judge of the Supreme Court can also be appointed as the chairperson. And earlier, the commission consisted of a chairperson, two judicial members, one member amongst the judges of the Supreme Court, other member amongst the Chief Justice of a High Court. Then it had two members to be appointed from amongst persons having knowledge of or practical experience in human rights. This two members has now been increased to three members, out of which at least one shall be a woman. In addition to these members, there were also deemed members or deemed to be members of the commission. Earlier, chairpersons of National Commission for Minorities, National Commission for Scheduled Castes, National Commission for Scheduled Tribes, National Commission for Women, they shall be deemed to be members. However, in the recent amendment included the chairperson of National Commission for Backward Classes, chairperson of National Commission for Protection of Child Rights, and the Chief Commissioner for Persons with Disabilities also to be included as deemed members of the commission. Then the Amendment Act aims to reduce the term of the chairperson and members of the commission and also the state commissions from 5 to 3 years, and they are also be eligible for reappointment. And with respect to state commissions, that is the State Human Rights Commission, the Amendment Act provided that a person who has been a judge of a high court is also made eligible to be appointed as chairperson, in addition to a person who has been the Chief Justice of the High Court. Then the Amendment Act also conferred the functions relating to human rights being discharged by union territories upon the state commissions. However, with respect to Union Territory of Delhi, the functions related to human rights will be discharged by National Human Rights Commission. These are some of the important points with reference to the analysis of this news article concerning some of the important amendments brought by the 2019 Amendment Act. However, a very important amendment proposal was there since the coming into force of the principal law, that is to make these commissions as a body whose orders are binding on the government. Right now, the orders of NHRC and SHRCs are not binding on the government. They are only recommendatory in nature. However, on the other hand, if you take information commissions, Central Information Commission or State Information Commission, according to Section 19(7) of the Right to Information Act, their orders are binding on the public authority. However, many human rights defenders, they point to the fact that the 2019 Amendment Act did not take into consideration of this very important crucial proposal so as to make these commissions whose orders must be binding. Right now, it is only recommendatory in nature. Now, let's move on to the next part of the discussion. So this discussion is based on this editorial article that talks about the nuclear relations between the United States and the North Korea. In this discussion, we will see about the tensions between US and North Korea over this matter, the possible approaches to arrive at a common ground among these two, and also the way forward. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, as per reports, North Korea is reportedly have made rapid progress in its weapons program. It is said to have active and increasingly sophisticated nuclear weapons and also ballistic missiles. In addition to this, it is also believed that it possesses chemical and biological weapons. And even after years of heavy sanctions imposed on it for its nuclear measures, North Korea continues to practice its weapon activities. Now, coming to recent times, just days before the inauguration of US President, North Korea disclosed a new type of submarine-launched ballistic missile at a military showcase. It declared this particular ballistic missile to be the world's most powerful weapon. Also know that the Supreme Leader of North Korea has pledged to expand the nuclear arsenal of North Korea and its military potential by outlining a list of desired weapons. These weapons include long-range ballistic missiles and super-large warheads. So in this backdrop, the new US President, President Biden, in his recent address to a joint session of the Congress, remarked about North Korea's nuclear policy. He said that the Iran and North Korea's nuclear programs, they present a serious threat to the security of both United States and also the security of the world. He further ensured to address these threats through diplomacy and also through stern deterrence. As a response to these observations made by Biden, North Korea accused that Biden's administration is being hostile to North Korea. However, if you come to approaches, after reviewing the US policy towards North Korea, the present US president is likely to adopt a strategy somewhere between Barack Obama and Donald Trump. If you take Barack Obama, he followed the policy of strategic patience, whereas Donald Trump practiced or focused in conducting a top-level summit between the two countries in dealing with the nuclear challenge. Because Mr. Donald Trump did strive for achieving a single sweeping deal with Kim Jong-un. Whereas former President Barack Obama followed strategic patience, where he sought to compel the North Korea to come for negotiations, and how it will come for negotiations? By imposing sanctions and by imposing other forms of pressure. But both approaches have failed and North Korea is keeping on expanding its nuclear arsenal and other arsenal. And this has made North Korea to remain as an unresolved foreign policy puzzle for the US government. However, Biden's approach, as per the words of White House Press Secretary, is to have a careful, practical approach that is open to diplomacy with North Korea. It will also try to make practical progress that increases the security of the United States and its allies. Now let's come to possibilities, present possibilities, how to deal with North Korea. See, after Mr. Biden assumed office, North Korea conducted short-range missile tests. And this was viewed by the United States as a kind of provocation. And it is reported that after carefully studying the scenario, Mr. Biden do not have many good options in dealing with North Korea. If you see, the main goal of US in Northeastern Asia is denuclearization of Korean Peninsula. And many report that the only possible way to achieve this is by diplomacy, that is by having discussions, negotiations with North Korea. This is because if you go with a military strike on North Korea, it will not be considered as a clever decision because North Korea is a nuclear weapon state. If it retaliates, it will be a catastrophe for the entire world. Now, in terms of Trump-Kim summit, one good aspect is that even though they did not lead to any success or development, it created a diplomatic momentum for engagement. And North Korea, though it issues threats to expand its nuclear program, it sticks to self-imposed moratorium or temporary prohibition on nuclear tests and long-range ballistic missile tests in the current scenario. So these two positive measures on one side, we can also find a situation in North Korea where it is going to a tough economic crisis. Even its supreme leader Kim Jong himself admitted that his five-year economic plan for the country failed to meet targets in almost every sector. And mainly this is because North Korea closed its borders in last January, that is in 2020, to prevent the spread of COVID-19, and this has separated it mainly from its neighbor and ally China. As a result, in fact, the trade between North Korea and China dropped by about 80%. In addition to this, typhoons and floods have also devastated homes and crops in North Korea. And then North Korea faces strict international sanctions, including the sanctions over its nuclear program. All these aspects together have led to the deterioration of North Korean economy. So to conclude, this is the right time for Mr. Biden to make use of this opportunity so as to arrive at a common ground with Mr. Kim. On one side, he can talk about denuclearization with North Korea. On the other side, he can extend help with respect to removing sanctions or solving economic worries of North Korea. This could be considered as new North Korean strategy, which should be the focus of Biden's administration. That is what is the crux of the article. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this editorial. In the discussion, we saw about the tensions between US and North Korea and the nuclear sphere, the possible approaches, the approach of Barack Obama, the strategic passions, the top-level symmetry of Donald Trump, then what are the challenges currently faced by North Korea in this COVID-19 world, in this world that faces COVID-19 as a dangerous threat. Then we saw what could be new North Korean strategy of US government. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article talks about Purchasing Managers Index. First, let us see about the index and then we will discuss the article. See, Purchasing Managers Index is a survey-based economic indicator. It is designed to provide a timely insight into business conditions. This index is widely used to anticipate changing economic trends in official data like the GDP. It is also used as an alternative measure to the official data about a country's economic performance and business conditions. See, the PMI data are used by financial and corporate professionals to better understand where economies and markets are headed to, and it helps them to uncover or to explore various opportunities. See, this index, it is compiled and produced globally by a company called as IHS Markit. This index is produced for more than 40 economies worldwide, including India. Know that originally, Purchasing Managers Index was compiled for manufacturing sector only. Later, it was extended to include other sectors like services, construction and retail. Today's focus is Manufacturing Purchases Managing Index. It is a survey-based economic indicator that is designed to provide a timely insight into changing business conditions in the goods producing sector. That is the key point here. It is the weighted average of 5 indices, which are new orders, output, employment, suppliers' delivery times and inventories of goods purchases. So based on the data by Purchasing Managers Index or the Manufacturing PMI, we can assess India's manufacturing sector activity. Now the news is regarding India's manufacturing PMI for April 2021. It was at 55.5. See, if the index is more than 50, that means there is good improvement over the previous month. And since the number is 55.5, it is said that there is a solid improvement in the health of manufacturing sector. And among the categories in the sector, consumer goods was the strongest performing category. This was followed by capital goods and then intermediate goods. If you take the reading for the month of March 2021, it was again 55.4. That meant there is again a solid improvement compared to the previous month. Any number above 50 means expansion as per the manufacturing PMI released by IHS Markit. Then with reference to India, the output index and new orders index also expanded for April 2021. But this expansion was the slowest in 8 months. The reason for expansion was due to pickup in demand and marketing efforts. But the slowest expansion in output index and new orders index is because of surging COVID cases in the country. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article, wherein we discussed about manufacturing purchasing managers index released by IHS Market and how to assess for a particular economy, wherein we saw India's performance in April 2021. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article talks about the decision of Manipur High Court. See, the Manipur High Court allowed 7 nationals of Myanmar to travel to New Delhi so as to seek protection from United Nations Refugee Agency, that is the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. The decision was arrived as though India is not a party to UN Refugee Convention, it is still a party to international human rights standards such as Universal Declaration of Human Rights, then International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. High Court also stated that the important and extreme protection afforded by Article 21 is available to citizens and also to non-citizens, and it also encompasses the right of non-refoulement. That is, you should not force a refugee or asylum seeker back to the country or a place wherein they are liable to be subjected to persecution. Which means, as we know, the situation in Myanmar is now in the hands of military junta. If these 7 nationals are asked to go to Myanmar, they may face persecution there. So they should not be returned there. So that is the right of non-refoulement or the principle of non-refoulement. So in this regard, let us see about the UN Refugee Agency, which is UNHCR, which has its headquarters at Geneva in Switzerland. See, United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees is a global organization whose primary purpose is to safeguard the rights and well-being of those people who have been forced to flee. Obviously, these include refugees, returnees, people who are considered stateless, and those people who are displaced internally and also asylum seekers. See, UN High Commissioner for Refugees was first created in the year 1950 during the aftermath of Second World War. The purpose was to help millions of Europeans who had fled or lost their homes in the last decade, that is during the Second World War. Now, coming to the key legal elements that form the basis of this agency, it is the 1951 Refugee Convention and the 1967 Protocol associated with this Refugee Convention. Right of non-refoulement forms the core principle of these agreements. And remember, India is not a signatory to this 1951 Refugee Convention or to its 1967 Protocol. And India is alleged by some countries and some human rights defenders as not having a national refugee protection framework in consonance with international human rights refugee standards or in consonance with international refugee rights standards. Now let's come to the governance of this UN Refugee Agency. See, UN High Commissioner for Refugees is governed by UN General Assembly and the UN Economic and Social Council. The Executive Committee of UNHCR, it approves the agency's biennial programs and the corresponding budget. And these are presented by the High Commissioner, who is appointed by UN General Assembly. And note that it is the High Commissioner who is responsible for direction and control of this agency. And she or he will be directing the agency's work with the assistance of Deputy High Commissioner and Assistant High Commissioners for the protection and operations. Now coming to the funds of this agency, see, these are mostly voluntary contribution. 86% of the funds come from governments and the European Union. 3% come from other intergovernmental organizations and pooled funding mechanisms. 10% of the fund comes from private sector. This includes funds that are coming from foundations, corporations, and also the public. Note this point, that the agency receives funding from the private sector also. They also receive a limited subsidy of 1% from UN budget for their administrative costs, and they also accept in-kind contributions like taking items like tents, aids like medicines and drugs. They also work with other sister UN agencies whose work complements or converges with this UN Refugee Agency. Some of the agencies who are considered as partner agencies of UN Refugee Agency is World Food Programme, UNICEF, WHO, UN Development Programme, Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs, then UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, and also the Joint UN Programme on HIV or AIDS, or UN AIDS. So these are some of the important points with reference to the analysis of this news article, through which we discussed about UN Refugee Agency, which is also called as UN High Commissioner for Refugees. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. See this question. Consider the following statements with respect to the two organizations, Organization of the Petroleum Exporting Countries and Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation. Three statements are given. They are asking which of the statements given above are correct. First statement, OPEC is a subsidiary organization of APEC. The statement is incorrect. There is no relation between OPEC and APEC. OPEC is an organization of oil exporting nations, but APEC is a regional economic forum. It was established in 1989 so as to leverage the growing interdependence of the Asia-Pacific. APEC, that is the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, aims to create greater prosperity for the people of Asia-Pacific region by promoting balanced, inclusive, sustainable, innovative and secure growth, and also by accelerating regional economic integration. So first statement is incorrect. See the second statement, all the members of APEC are members of OPEC. This again is also incorrect. If you see currently, not even one member of Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation is a member of Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries. OPEC has 13 members and APEC has 21 members. Third statement, India is a member of neither organizations. That means India is not a member of both these organizations. This statement is correct. So third statement is the only correct statement. Therefore, the correct answer is option C, 3 only. See this question with reference to UNHCR. Three statements are given. They are asking which of the statements given above are correct. The office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees serves as the guardian of the 1951 Refugee Convention and its 1967 Protocol. This statement is correct. The convention expressly provides that states are expected to cooperate with UNHCR in ensuring that the rights of refugees are respected and protected. See statement 2, India is a signatory of 1951 Refugee Convention and its 1967 Protocol relating to the status of refugees. This statement is incorrect because India is not a signatory of 1951 Refugee Convention or its 1967 Protocol. Third statement, the cornerstone of 1951 Convention is the principle of non-refoulement. This statement is correct. It is mentioned in Article 33 of this 1951 Convention. According to this principle, a refugee should not be returned to a country where she or he faces serious threats to her or his life or freedom. So first and third statements are correct. So the correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. Which one of the following countries of Southwest Asia does not open out to Mediterranean Sea? Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Israel. You can find that Syria, Lebanon and Israel, they border Mediterranean Sea, or they open out to Mediterranean Sea. It is Jordan that does not open out to Mediterranean Sea. Correct answer option B. See this question with reference to Purchasing Managers Index. Which of the following statements, ISRA, are not correct with reference to Purchasing Managers Index often seen in news? It provides timely insight into changing business conditions in the goods producing sector. See, this statement is correct. It is compiled and released by World Bank. See, this statement is incorrect. See, at a global level, for around 40 economies including India, this is being released and it is compiled and released by IHS Markit. There are some national PMI surveys that are released, but these are released by, say, for US, it is released by Institute for Supply Management. For Denmark, it is released by Danish Purchasing and Logistics Forum. For Canada, it is released by IWAY Business School. For Singapore, it is released by SIPMM Institute, which is the educational arm of Singapore Institute of Purchasing and Materials Management. So these are all on the national basis. At the global level, we have the Purchasing Managers Index released by IHS Markit. Coming to statement 3, it is released only for the manufacturing sector. Now this statement is incorrect. Originally, IHS Markit compiled and released PMI for manufacturing sector only, but later it was extended to include other sectors such as services, construction and retail also. The first statement is correct because it does not say only. Here the question asks for incorrect statements. Therefore, correct answer is option D, 2 and 3 only are incorrect. Mains questions are given for practicing. You may write the answer and post them in the comment section for peer review. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share the resource among those who are in need of such resources, and subscribe to Shankar AS Academy for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.